Now we're going to make a transition to a panel discussion with Jeff and three of our most distinguished faculty at the College of Education. Each faculty member represents one of our three departments in the college and three distinct disciplines. They've dedicated their lives and research to literacy and or motivating readers. First is Dr. Jennifer Turner, who is an associate professor in the Department of Teaching, Learning, Policy, and Leadership at the college. And Jennifer focuses on culturally responsive reading pedagogies in elementary classrooms and the development of vision-oriented teachers. Please welcome Dr. Turner to the stage. Dr. Jade Wexler is an assistant professor in the Department of Counseling, Higher Education, and Special Education. Dr. Wexler focuses on developing and evaluating reading interventions for adolescents with reading disabilities and behavior disorders. She also focuses on effective adolescent literacy practices for teachers. So please welcome Dr. Wexler. Dr. Alan Wigfield is a professor in the Department of Human Development and Quantitative Methodology at the college and serves as Director of Graduate Studies for the Human Development Program. His research focuses on the development of children's achievement, motivation, children's motivation for reading, and intervention programs to enhance children and adolescents' motivation in reading and other areas. Please welcome Dr. Wigfield. And I'm going to start by asking our distinguished faculty to take about 5 minutes apiece and share with you their perspectives and research on literacy and learning as it relates to their academic discipline. And I'm going to start with you, Dr. Turner.
Okay, well, thank you so much. And thank you, Jeff, for that wonderful, wonderful talk you gave. I feel like I can't go after that. I was wondering if Jay could start out, actually. But I just wanted to kind of pick up on some of the things that you were saying about the connections between drawing and writing, because I've been seeing some of that kind of connection in my own work on multimodal research. And I do work in culturally responsive teaching, and one of the things I've been realizing is that culture goes beyond many times just race or gender or language or religion, things that we think of as the typical cultural dimensions. And one of the things I've been thinking about is culture in terms of students' career interests and their goals, actually. And so one of the things I've had them do in our summer reading program that we run in the summer is have some of the kids actually draw what they want to be when they grow up. And so they will draw pictures of being basketball players or being police officers, or some of the girls want to be cheerleaders and teachers. And one of the things the teachers told me in having them draw is that I would also ask them to like talk a little bit about their pictures, and the kids would actually start to write so much more, they were saying, than they typically would write. And so writing for them became a way to describe their picture, describe their dreams, describe their hopes, but so much of that was built into the creative design process that you were talking about. And so I've actually begun to think of kids as designers of their own career interests, designers of their future hopes and goals. And so much of that I've tried to help them see as part of literacy. And so some of them would say, you know, hey, I want to be in the military. I'll never have to read again. You know, I'm not, and that's why I chose this career. And so I've tried to talk with them a little bit more about, well, maybe it's not reading or writing that you like to do, but what do you think about listening to someone? And they'll be like, oh yeah, I got to listen to my commanding officer. And so it was a way to start thinking more broadly about literacy, but it was all based on their drawings. It was using that as a touchstone for them and to tap into their passions and what they saw as important to themselves. And I think that for me has been some of the most powerful research, because it just reminds me that culture is just who we are. It's just a shared group of values and experiences that groups have. And so for these kids, that's their future, and they want to be part of that. They want to create that. And so the what you were talking about just reminded me of how much you went through in creating your drawings, but coming to that design process helped you prepare for who you are, and that resilience, I think, is so important. And that's part of what I'm trying to do with my work, is build in resilience through the drawing process, and hopefully it will lead to more writing. Hopefully teachers can then build on some of the career interests that these kids have to lean towards more informational text and things like that to help them learn more about careers and grow their futures.
Something that I wonder about a lot is our kids, of course, kids are, have always been visual. Everybody's visual, you know, all human beings are visual. But I wonder if you asked me right now to write a book, if my publisher said, I want you to write the next book, but no pictures. I would say, I would never, that would be a career suicide for me, right? And I wonder if kids today have a greater visual expectation to everything that they consume. If you look at, say, Facebook versus Snapchat, right? Kids use Snapchat.
Yes.
They don't need the words, they need the picture.
Right.
And so I just wonder if kids are, I wonder if we're seeing a bit of an evolution with kids right now that's informed by the social media that they use.
Yeah, I agree.
Yeah. So thank you for that. Yeah. And okay, now Dr. Wexler, you wanna talk a little bit about what your research is?
First I wanted to say that that was great, really interesting. But I live on a cul-de-sac and in a pretty decent area. And there are about 8 second to fourth grade kids that live on my cul-de-sac. And for whatever reason, they absolutely love my yard. They have yards of their own, but they have claimed my yard as their own. So they're constantly playing soccer in the yard, shooting like these foam rockets off of my walkway, all these things. So I went out there the other day and I had my Wimpy Kid books. And usually they just kind of move around me and they're like, you know, what are you doing in our field kind of thing. And this time they all came like swarming, you know, they swarmed me and they were all like, why do you have those books? We know those books. And before I knew it, they're like, hee 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 and telling me all about, well, Raleigh does this and that. And I said, okay, I'm gonna bring back something really insightful to this presentation. And so I asked them, you know, what is so motivating about these books? Can you read the words? And they said, oh yeah, we can read the words. And I thought, that's pretty good because, you know, there's some good multisyllabic words in there and some good vocabulary and all that. And I, you know, they said, well, they love the pictures, of course. And then the general consensus was the stories are funny and silly and weird and awesome. And I said, all right, that's scientific enough. They're funny and silly and weird and awesome. So anyways, I started thinking about these kids and kind of compared to the students that I work with. And these students in my cul-de-sac, you know, they go to Montgomery County Public Schools, some of them go to private schools, they have experiences, they go to summer camp, they go to the country club and you probably drink or order too many smoothies or whatever they did in the book. But I work with adolescent struggling readers, students with disabilities. These aren't just reluctant readers. A lot of them are non-readers and very at risk for dropping out of school. Many of them have dropped out. And then I work with kids in the incarcerated setting. So I started thinking about a couple studies. And there was one back in 2001 by McCrae, Vaughn, and Neal. And they interviewed these middle school readers with students with disabilities about their perceptions of themselves as readers, their willingness to participate in reading instruction, and what kinds of reading instruction that they were receiving. And you know, they all pretty much said, yeah, we want to learn to read more, but they couldn't really describe any good reading instruction that they were a part of or they were receiving. And so we've really, or the authors decided, well, maybe they're not really getting any good reading instruction. So years later, a couple of my colleagues and I, we replicated that study in the juvenile correctional facility setting with kids that have obviously struggled for a lot of years. But we found a very similar finding, that they were inherently motivated to read. But interestingly, these kids really saw reading as if you could decode the words on the page, that was reading. They didn't really understand that the purpose of reading was to learn. And I think a lot of it comes from their backgrounds, not having a good model of reading, not being exposed to good instruction early on. They get to those islands on the page that are maybe in these expository texts that they're reading, which, you know, would be a graph in, you know, a book or in the science textbook or a map in a social studies textbook. And they don't look at those islands and know how to use that to help them with comprehension. They look at it and they think, sweet, less for me to read, and then they keep going, right? So they all said that they did not get any of that good reading instruction in their regular schools. They began to disengage, and then they weren't motivated to learn more. And so that really kind of exemplifies what we call the Matthew effect, which is the rich get richer and the poor get poorer. So those kids in my cul-de-sac that are getting this good reading instruction and they're exposed to life experiences, they have what we call this instructional Velcro, and that their trajectory is, you know, typically on this upward trend where these other reluctant readers and everything, they don't have that instruction or even that background knowledge. And so, fast forward, we did some other observational research, actually funded by a University of Maryland seed grant. The president's over there, so I have to say that. But where we confirmed a lot of this, that in fact, right now in some of the middle schools and high schools where we want to see some of these content area teachers really integrating vocabulary and comprehension practices, they're not doing that. And in fact, a lot of these teachers are completely circumventing the use of text altogether in class. Understandably so, they have a majority of their kids who are struggling readers, but pressure to get through content. And so we're really finding that right now. And so anyway, so in terms of motivation, I think it's an easy answer in some respects, but a hard thing to do is good instruction. And good instruction that's evidence-based and data-based is something that a lot of these students need and that will help them start to learn, and that's very motivating. And so a lot of my work focuses on that.
We went to I went to China last year, and we had kind of a major media event around the Wimpy Kid books, and it was really interesting. I thought that we were going to have a standard consumer kind of moment, and instead the media was there, and then the publishers were really advocating for this type of book in China, because they were saying, look, here's what the kids are forced to read and they hate it. You know, they showed these like dry textbooks, and they said, and here's, you know, this kind of work, this kind of multimodal, is that what you would actually call it? Is, you know, it will really motivate them. And I'm not saying Diary of Wimpy Kid is the solution to everything, but I think that adults read for pleasure. Kids need, I think that's part of the message. They need to have successful moments at reading where they're reading for themselves and not because an adult, you know, told them to do it. I also noticed with my kids is like they went right from Barney to really inappropriate, like, you know, television. And I think it was because they could sniff out the adult. You know, they went along with the Barney for a while, but then they're like, there's a heavy hand behind all of this, you know, about singing about holding hands while crossing the street or something like that. I need something a little more edgy. So I do think that there is actually a real purpose behind having work that is a little bit looser or speaks to a kid's interest more. John Chesko always says that if your kid likes sharks, then find everything you can on sharks. You know, magazines and books, and even if you don't approve of it, you know, that's what you got to put in front of kids. Mm-hmm. So.
Thank you, Dr. Weisler. And so now, Dr. Wigfield, do you want to give us a little bit to think about?
Well, thanks a lot. I really enjoyed your talk. It's definitely a talk about motivation and persistence and keeping at it and believing in yourself even when you're getting all of those even impersonal rejection letters. And I think it shows the importance of hanging in there and keeping going even when there's problems to face. And so a lot of my work over many years has been on the development of motivation. And is motivation important in school? It really is in so many ways. A few years back, a former Secretary of Education, Terrell Bell, was giving a speech on education to a group of educators. And he said, there's three things you need to know about education. The first one is motivation. The second one is motivation. And the third one is motivation. So I mean, from his perspective, when kids are not motivated, they're not going to maybe do the elaborate sorts of cognitive things they need to do to process materials and books that they get presented to in school. And so we and others have been interested in what happens to kids' motivation across the school year. So just quickly think about a kindergarten classroom when you walk into one and see what's going on there. And the teacher says, let's get our books out. And everybody goes, yay, let's get our books out. It's time for reading. Now let's fast forward to sixth grade. And you see all of the excitement in the hallways. And then the kids traipse into the classrooms. And the teacher says, let's get your reading book out. OK, I'll get my reading book out. And so what happens during that time period? What we and others have found is that kids come to school with an excitement for learning, a belief that they can accomplish the things that they are able to do, and a real deep love for learning in many ways. And this is true of many kids here and in many other places. But over the course of the school years, a lot of kids really begin to lose those feelings of competence, of interest, and intrinsic motivation. And we've seen that in study after study. It's particularly true for boys in reading. So it's interesting to me that you focus so much on connecting boys into reading, because our work and others shows that boys are the ones that particularly lose the interest and the value of reading over the school years. When we went to middle school and some of our own work, what we found was when we were asking kids about the science texts that they were reading, is that they said, we were about to do an intervention, and I said, well, these texts are boring, they're irrelevant to us, and they're really, really hard. So contrast that to how the kids are approaching yearbooks with the excitements and interest and really wanting to get at them. And so there's a real problem, I think, with a lot of the materials that the kids face in school, and so what we can do to sort of boost that is really critical. So the kind of depressing part of my talk here is that kids start out really positive and tend to get more negative over the course of the school years. But the good news, you had shared some bad and good news in your own life with us earlier, and I have some good news as well. There's been a lot of interventions over the last 10 years from the motivation field that have really been able to show that we can change kids' motivation and reading in a positive way, along with their understanding of the reading strategies they need, and finally, ultimately, their achievement. And we've been focusing in that work on information books, on the kind of dry textbooks that the kids told us initially they didn't like very much. And by doing a number of instructional practices that focus particularly on motivation, rather than thinking about motivation as just something we need to start with, it's like, okay, let's get excited, now we're motivated, and then doing a really boring lesson, that's just not gonna do it. So instead, we focus on a number of things. We try to get the kids doing some really interesting activities that engage them initially. We have books that then tie very directly to those activities, so they see that reading ties to what they're learning from that, and we let them answer their own questions about what they're doing rather than imposing them on them. We give them a lot of choice in the materials that they read. Choices that are constrained, you have to be sure that kids are making choices that help them rather than hurt them, but still choice nevertheless. Lots of chances to interact with other kids, to collaborate with others, that gets to be especially important at middle school. And also, particularly for the kids that are struggling, giving them books that they can read so they can build the kind of success and the sense of efficacy that can carry them through as they get their more challenging books. We've done that both at elementary and middle school and have a lot of success of boosting kids' engagement and achievement in reading. There's been another whole set of intervention work around motivation recently, just simply focusing on trying to build people's value for what they're reading by having them write about it or read inspiring quotes about that. Very simple idea, something you think wouldn't have a lot of powerful effects, but in study after study, these are having really big effects on kids' engagement in STEM across high school and college courses in a variety of settings. So many kids' motivation decreases, but it doesn't have to be that way. And by talking about the kind of instructional practices Jade was talking about, building some particular ideas to enhance motivation, we can really help kids build that motivation and engagement for books more than the Wimpy Kids books, which they love, but maybe some books that they have to persevere through to get learning other kinds of things. So
something I think about a lot, something I would love to do, is to write a, not to write the contents of a math book, but to take a math book and take the and pepper it with humorous drawings or drawings that fit the context of the situation is something that doesn't feel orthodox, but might be a motivation to get kids through. And I was a Cub Scout leader for years, and I would look at the pictures in those Cub Scout books, and I said, you know, and they're very old-fashioned. And I said, if I was a kid seeing this, you know, these really corny, like 1930s era drawings, I would be so turned off to the, you know, to this. I don't know, you know, I need to see something that's relevant to me. And I think that, you know, in those kinds of cases, I think it would be really interesting to see somebody break through that, the orthodoxy or, you know, the old-fashionedness and try something really different and daring to see if it made an effect on comprehension. Mm-hmm. You know, you could prove, you know, much, like 80% better comprehension or something with something that's very arch or playful. You know, that would be cool.
So you just defined two new career paths. You said right. You were looking for what they do next. There you go. There's two ideas.
I would love to do that. I'm a history book Even the Bible, you know, I mean, you can only get away with so much.
Yeah.
Some things aren't funny.
It's our list.
But I like the idea of trying just to see if the comprehension goes up, to pepper the text with something more playful.
I think all three of these researchers are interested in what we can do to raise comprehension levels. I think many of us in this room are interested in that. So I kind of want to throw out a question and just kind of let you all interact with this question and think a little bit. I think you've begun to do this, particularly Jeff's presentation, but help us think about what it is that in the Wimpy Kids that kind of pulls in readers. And I'm sure, Jeff, you have a lot of examples where kids have told you that, and I'm kind of curious about how our faculty think about that, too. And are there just some of those features that really stand out to you, any of you, or what themes or structures do you think that really do that? When I talk about pull in, I'm talking about almost the motivation, because we've all talked about the motivation that young boys have with these readers, and I'm just kind of curious what you all might have noticed about that and what you might think pulls people in.
Well, one of the things, I live in Virginia, so I couldn't go back and get my son. He's 13, and thank you so much for signing the book Elijah. because he was like, oh, Mom, you are taking a book, and I need it signed, because I couldn't bring him back. But I texted him, I said, you know, oh, I'm getting ready to meet Mr. Kinney, and is there anything you want me to say? And he asked me to say, please tell Mr. Kinney that I really like his books. I like that the pictures show Greg's emotions. And so for me, it's the emotional space that you enter with these books. It's very relevant, I think, for boys especially, because so many of them don't know how to express emotions, or they feel uncomfortable with that. And so I think for him, it was the pull-in, not only of having a male protagonist, but one that would say, like, these irreverent things, or also had the annoying brother like Roderick, had the friend like Rowley, and for my son and I, it actually became one of those kind of, you were saying Harry Potter brings kids and parents together, but I actually had a lot of those interactions around my son and I reading books, because he would say to me, Mom, look at this picture, look at read this, read what he did to Rowley, can you believe it? And I'm like, oh man, you know, that seems like a jerk right now. And we would have these conversations that would allow me into his world much more so than if I said, how are you doing? Who are you sitting at with, you know, in lunch? Where are you sitting? Who are you talking to? He'd be like, whatever, I'm cool, this is fine. But we entered into the space of, you know, what does it mean to be a good friend? What does it mean to be the middle child, and you have this older brother and this younger brother, and you have the parents around you? What is all of that about? And so there's a really great metaphor for looking at literature that Leigh Galda talks about, and she talks about this idea of windows and mirrors. And some books are mirrors for kids, and I feel like for my son, and I think for many boys, the Wimpy Kids, it's really a mirror for them. They can see themselves, it's relevant to their lives, it's just what they would think. And for me, it's been a window, because it's a window into his life that I would not have actually been able to tap into some of the feelings he's had or some of the experiences he's had. So he was a safety, for example, like Greg, and some of the same experiences with being a safety he kind of related to. But he wouldn't tell me about his experiences. He showed me Greg's experiences in the book. And so for me, it was much more of a window. And I think that metaphor is just a powerful way of thinking about your books, because I think for so many kids, it can certainly serve as a mirror. And I think girls like it too. I mean, my niece reads them. I mean, there are girls that like it too. And so there are those mirror and window books for kids. And I think the Wimpy Kids series really does both.
That's interesting. Something that caused me a lot of stress when my publishing house told me that it was a book for kids is I was like, there's a lot of stuff in here that is, it's not that it's bad. It's that you have to understand the humor, the irony, I'm not sure what the right word is for it. And I'll give you an example, is that Greg at one point chases some kindergartners with a worm on a stick. Yeah. And Rowley is, you know, it's a case of mistaken identity. Somebody thinks that Rowley did it.
Right.
And Greg's mother challenges him to do the right thing and, you know, do the right thing. And so Greg thinks that the right thing is to let Rally take the fall, you know, because that's better, that's good for Greg. And right. Rally's learned a lesson, be careful who you lend your coat to.
Right.
And that's the kind of thing I can get away with in the books, and it teaches a bad lesson. But I think that the kids, I think the kids like that. Like it because it causes dissonance. And that dissonance isn't, you know, that's unusual for a kid's book because of what I said before is that you, if I was writing that book for a kid, and now when we make the movies, you can't get away with that.
Right,
you
right.
cannot get away with that right. in the movies. You have to right all, you know, wrongs. And so it's, a, but that's something that's fun about the books. I think the British would call it cheeky humor,
mm,
you
yes,
know? And yes. so I think that the best compliment I ever got for the books is that you can't sense the adult behind the character Greg, and that's what I don't always achieve that, but that's what I strive for.
Maybe two comments that I'd add is, because Jen said things really, really well there. So you talked in your speech about the universality of childhood and the kids all over the world are going through similar kinds of things in many ways, or you know, the experience of puberty and the experience of being sandwiched in between and relations between boys and girls and all of that. And I think that really is one of the main things. But we also have used the term relevance a lot tonight. And I think that's really clear that they see the books as relevant for you. But I think the interesting thing to think of next is how can that feeling be transferred to the books that the kids are experiencing in school and maybe not feeling that either universality or relevance. And to the extent that some of those things can be built in to instruction and others to have kids make those connections more. It doesn't have to be personally interesting every time, but at least relevant or seeing some purpose for what they're doing. Then they're gonna maybe, probably not grab onto the way that they grab onto a wimpy kid book, but at least spend the time to get through it and learn a lot from them so they can move ahead in different areas. So those are, I think, two comments there.
Yeah, I was gonna say the relevance of it and that they can really, you know, they can really relate to the stories, which I think even if they couldn't read all the words in there, they didn't totally understand the illustration, that they still can get through it and they can still comprehend it. But in some of the books in school that, you know, they don't understand this text on ecosystems, or they don't have a clue what this thing is on electromagnetic whatever, you know, how can they get through that and comprehend that? And but I think, you know, obviously they relate to this and they think it's funny. My friends son is in second grade, and she said that they have a lot of the Wimpy Kid books in there, and that the teacher describes them as their candy books, and these are your, in a good way, like sure. these are your candy books and all of that. Sometimes you have to read the lima bean ones too, but they all of course go and run for those candy books because that's what they're motivated and interested in reading. So.
But I guess some of those books that they use at school need some of Jeff's illustrations that he
they
described.
They do, they need some help, or they need yeah,
so many people in the audience are educators, and I'm just thinking about what we might talk about related to what takeaway or what suggestion educators might gain from some of the things that you've thought about as you've been thinking about the books. And you probably have, you've talked to teachers a lot, I know, too, so there may be some suggestions you have for teachers or educators.
Our other panelists would be much more accomplished or much more qualified to answer that.
I'll let them start out. I'm sure you'll have some
I'll
responses.
I'll come up with something to sound smart. Yeah.
Well, I was thinking, I know that so many schools have to teach to Common Core standards and emphasize informational text, and I know that's very important. But I think it's also important not to forget that there is a literary set of standards, and I think that some of the strategies that you can use actually connect really nicely with Common Core. So there's a strategy called close reading, where I think you could actually use passages from your books, both with the illustrations and with the text, to have kids really dive in deeply and take a passage and learn, have the kids talking about character traits, for example, how the characters might change, or talking mm-hmm. about a theme or a main idea in the text through using just a passage. It may not be a book that you can use for the entire class, although I'm sure there are teachers that even read this book aloud and show pictures. I think that's just as powerful. I see the book a lot on classroom library shelves, as Jay was mentioning, sort of like the candy book, but I think eyes on text in that time that kids are reading is important if they're reading it independently. And so I encourage teachers to use this in ways that make sense for you, for your students, meets their needs, meets the curricular goals that you're trying to establish. But there's no reason why you can't have fun at some times with these texts. And I think Whoopi Kids just lends itself so nicely because it's a series and has a deeper sort of character development that you can really get into some interesting conversations with kids about relationships, about different literary devices. So I notice also in your text you have bold words sometimes, or words in all capitals, for example. And so these literary devices, that's another way that they can begin to analyze text and really begin to use text as evidence, not just to answer some questions, but to think about what's the author trying to tell me. It's more like author's purpose and thinking about, well, why did Jeff Kinney choose this kind of text or this way to present the illustrations or use these kinds of words and not others. So you start to get into the craft of writing, and I think that's the close reading and then you moving into a writer's craft would really be nice ways to use this and very beneficial for kids that are struggling with texts that are more information heavy. So those are things that come to mind for me.
I think one of the challenges in schools, and teachers know this better than I do, is there's so much pressure on testing and accountability and performance, and we have to learn this, that sometimes the broader purposes of learning and what kids are really there for get lost a bit. And but educational psychologist who was in the social studies field, Jerry Brophy, did a study a number of years ago in which he observed classroom instruction in social studies, and he said almost never did teachers talk about the purpose for what they were learning. It was just, okay, here's what we're doing today, and there's never that sort of step back to reflect on what's the bigger picture here, going back to the relevant sort of idea. I think another really key thing that we've seen in many successful teachers is their own enthusiasm for the topic that they're talking about and their own reading and modeling that for kids and just showing how much books can mean to their lives and helping kids can kind of see that as well. And I think especially when we get to middle school, building on some of the things that middle school kids really want, some autonomy, some choice, opportunities to interact with others. Reading sometimes is thought of as a solitary thing that we do in our beds at night, but it's often can be really active and social. And when kids are given those opportunities, they really thrive. Teachers have to structure that in meaningful ways, but it can be done in ways that can really build the motivation for reading different kinds of things.
Everything they said. Plus, I think, especially for these kids from maybe lower SES backgrounds, really building that background knowledge that they might not have before reading anything that they can read that's motivating is really good. Again, that instructional Velcro. Also, like Dr. Anita Archer talks a lot about don't commit assume-icide. You guys ever heard that? So don't assume that they're going to make certain connections, or we really need to model some of these strategies for them. What do good readers do? How do we understand these things? How do we break this down? And just really good explicit instruction. With the Wimpy Kid books, we can still pre-teach some vocabulary and how to read some of those words and how do we use some of those text features, just like we can some of the nonfiction books that these kids read. And I can tell you this one story that I was in one of the juvenile incarcerated settings, and I was there a little bit in advance of this intervention that we were gonna do with these kids, and they had this free reading time. And they had, I would say, the equivalent, maybe, of the Wimpy Kid books, not really, but like things that they thought were gonna be really motivating and relevant to them and interesting. And these books were about, which I later found out, gangs, sex, drugs, and rock and roll, okay? And so I go in and Lamont, he's like 6'5", and he's like, gives me the nod, and I'm like, here I come, I'm gonna save the world, I'm gonna read with Lamont and all that. And so he shoves this, copy of the book next to me, and I'm reading with him, and he wants to read. So he's muddling through, decoding this book, and there's like three different teachers in there, a couple security guards, all these people, and they're looking at me, and they're all just kind of like start looking away, and I'm like, what is the problem? And so he starts reading, and I'm like, oh my God, like, this is about a really inappropriate topic. And, he really wanted to read it, but so we get to the end, and I'm like, okay, you know, Lamont, what did, you know, can you tell me what you read about? Absolutely no clue. No comprehension. And I can tell you that was the first time ever that I was so happy this student had absolutely no comprehension. But so my point, I think, is that, you know, it's really good that they have these books and that they're motivated to read, but we need to do everything we can to really couple that with good explicit instruction and doing all the things that Jen and Alan talked about. So.
My third grader, we gave him a book one night called Gym Candy, and you know he just tore through it. Like two nights he read this, you know, 300-page book. And we found out afterwards it was about a high schooler using steroids. It was like, oh, this is going to be a long conversation. But something you said triggered a thought, and you know, obviously I'm not an expert in education in any sense, but I think for me, I was excited to hear there are so many teachers here tonight. Two things. One is that for me, the magic words were always when I was a kid. No matter who the authority figure was, whether it was a priest or a teacher or a principal, if they started with when I was a kid and told me anything about them as a kid, I was hooked. You know, and I just wonder how much, you know, it's just context, right? It's like you were talking about before, providing context for the why. And if you can start with stories that put you back in time, I think that's very powerful. And the other thing is that the most, this is very tangential, but there was a teacher that I had named Mrs. Norton. She was probably 65, very stout, kind of not the type of woman you expect to really relate to a young, you know, 9-year-old boy. But she was the best thing that ever happened to me in school. One of the things that she did was she challenged me to be better, even when I was doing well. And so I used to be a pretty good artist. I was a better illustrator in fifth grade than I am now. And I would show her my picture. I'd show all my classmates my pictures, my parents, my family. Everybody would say, "That's great, you know, it's great." And then she would point out the flaws in it and say, "You could have planned this better." And I remember it bothered me a lot. But I'm still talking about it now. And she did, you know, she did challenge me. And the other thing is that she could use humor in the classroom, and she also had a sense that I don't know if it can even be taught, where, for example, there was a kid in our school named James who was practically mute. He really didn't speak at all. And then on the last day of school, she said, "James, you have 5 minutes to do whatever you want." And he, without skipping a beat, he jumped up on the desk, did a soft shoe routine, and he did a whole Marx Brothers routine, and they just sat down quietly. And I don't know how she saw that in him, you know. But if you could replicate that teacher across, the age groups, we would have happier kids, I think.
So when Jane was telling her story, I remember it's kind of a joke that reading teachers talk about, and they talk about one reading teacher talking to a fifth grader who was reading Moby Dick, and she said, "You're really reading Moby Dick? That's such a very thick book, and you know, it's kind of an adult book, and it's really hard to read." He said, "Yeah, I'm reading Moby Dick, but I'm skipping all the stuff about the whales." So, wow, this has been a great conversation, but now we'd like to get you involved, all of you in the audience, and we'd be very interested in hearing your questions or your comments to any member of the panel and sort of your responses to some of the things that we've been hearing about this evening. So there's microphones on either side of the auditorium, and we'll see if we've got somebody that will come down. Well, Autumn, hello.
Hi, my name is Autumn. So this is my question. I was a reading teacher and am now a doctoral student here at the University of Maryland in the literacy department. Dr. Wickfield talked a bit about motivation, and I think it's clear that Wimpy Kid books motivate students to read. Dr. Turner also spoke a bit about how these books could be used instructionally in classrooms. And so as a reader myself and an educator, I think one of the goals of reading in school settings should be to ultimately help our students develop into lovers of reading. In what ways do you think teachers could use these books to translate the same level of interest and engagement to other texts?
Whoa, she asked you a hard question there, everyone.
you know, I mean, I think it's something that Jeff mentioned earlier about the success and feeling competent. And I think one of the things you have to do as a teacher is build these opportunities up so that students are successful and that they feel confident, and provide that kind of scaffolding when they're not. And so for me, it's thinking of ways to almost step kids through. When you were saying islands that they can jump to, you almost have to take that as an entire philosophy of instruction, that they're jumping to those electronic plate tectonics and this and electromagnetic that. They're jumping to that. That's an island for them that they can't swim to. And so how do we as teachers help them feel successful when they're out there in the middle of the waters? And I think for me, it's trying to build that stamina, almost this whole idea of reading stamina, where you can take texts like Wimpy Kids and help them see that it's going to be relevant. Maybe it's not relevant to their career choice, for example, but it may be relevant in some other way to their lives, and helping them see that relevance, but really scaffolding them to it, I think, is part of. They might not need the scaffolding to read your books, Jeff, but they need that hand-holding and that gradual release of responsibility maybe to get to that informational text. And then just maybe using some strategies. So one of my favorite is Sketch to Stretch, where you have kids, even with a nonfiction text, drawing out what it might mean for a caterpillar to become a butterfly, for example, and doing a life cycle kind of drawing. So you get kids to actually begin to use their own visual imaginations to then comprehend. And so those are ways to me that you can kind of tap into that and try to build upon the love that they have for the Diary of a Wimpy Kids kind of series, and almost thinking of content as a series. So there's a story of content that you need to be telling kids, that it doesn't feel like these isolated little facts and random ideas that they're learning. It needs to connect and have some coherence, just like a series book would. And so I think those are some ways I would come away from thinking about that.
It's interesting how much you use drawing to make some of those connections. Yeah. And I think you did that before you even heard Jeff talk, right? Yeah. Any other ways that you all can think about how to make those transitions?
I mean, I think, again, that, you know, these, they really relate well to the Wimpy Kid books, and they know something about that. And so to take it to something else that they don't know anything about is such a big leap for them. That, like, you, I know there's teachers out here, right? So you're familiar with, like, the KWL chart, right? So what do I know? What do I want to know? What did I learn? And a lot of times, and I used to do it as a teacher, we'd sit there and say, okay, like, what do you know about, you know, plate tectonics? And what do the kids do? They probably look where? At their shoes, because what superpower do they have when they look at their shoes? They're invisible, right? So, okay, so they don't know that much about these topics. And then, you know, but we sit there and we have them brainstorm about it. Or maybe someone says something and they know something, but it's not, it's wrong. And so the other people listened. And so now you have to kind of correct that. Or they said something, but it's not exactly the point that you want them to get from this text that you're about to have them read. And then it's, what do you want to know about this topic you've never heard about before? You know, and they're like, I don't care. I'm thinking about my girlfriend or whatever. And so I think, like, building background knowledge is not something to really underestimate for these students in taking it a step further. And I think that their background knowledge in these everyday experiences that Mr. Kinney writes about is very high. They have background knowledge in these silly things that happen. But when you take them to these other texts, they don't. And so that's maybe something that we can do. That's a really easy thing that teachers can do to enhance motivation to learn it and hopefully comprehension.
Good. DJ.
Hi, I'm DJ Bolger. I'm a professor in the College of Education. So one of the things that interested me when you said some of the kids that were coming up to you were children who you thought were seemingly on the spectrum, mostly boys. So I'm a neuroscientist who studies reading and reading comprehension. And more recently, I started studying children and adolescents on the spectrum who have, one of the ideas is that they have problems with social emotional processing, especially in language. And so we were interested in understanding, well, you know, what is it that breaks down, and we're looking in the brain. And interestingly enough, as we were doing this research, we found out that, in fact, the more that kids engage in fiction and in narratives, the more empathy and the more perspective taking that they have. We also, more recent research has shown that you have less anxiety, less depression. Those who read more and especially narratives. And so it's interesting to me that the fact that these kids who are on the spectrum, that they've been able to use your text. One of the things that our own research found is that if kids on the spectrum do have text and pictures, that they actually are, that those areas of the brain that we thought, they don't have empathy, they don't have, they actually do, actually more so, they're engaged when they have text and picture. So I just wondered, what were your experiences with these kids, who told you, especially in an age where, we're starting to say kids are losing empathy. Kids are, experiencing each other on the devices and not face to face. And so, one of the impacts of books like A Wimpy Kid is it's giving kids exposure to narrative, and giving them potentially more empathy. These complex situations, like you said, that, this what's right and wrong, this moral dilemma, those are complex issues, and the kids engage in them, and it's like a juice to them that they don't, I think, normally experience, or they don't often tap into, but through the narrative, as I said, building that empathy and perspective taking. But it'd be interesting to find out, what your interactions with these kids were like, and when they come up to you with their books.
They're usually, that's a great question, and I will have sort of a disappointing answer, because those interactions are usually really brief. When I meet these kids, we're churning through the line. But sometimes I do get authentic moments with these kids. And actually, one of the most authentic moments I had was when a mom with a kid who, I think he did have Asperger's, he came up and they both sort of nodded, and the kid teared up and the mom teared up, and that was it. It's like he knew and I knew, and he knew, that kind of thing. And that was really cool. But one kid just put it really plainly. He had Asperger's. He said to me, "The pictures tell me how they feel," and that's great. And it's like it's interesting, because with the frequency of the pictures in a book like Wimpy Kid, I think that it gives that constant feedback, which is I would imagine is very useful for a kid that needs to know how the characters feel.
Thanks. I'm going to jump over here for really quick, because I think there's going to be an important question coming up over here.
Right.
Hi, I'm Mason.
Hey, Mason.
I have a question. Why are your Diary of the Wimpy Kids all 217 pages long?
Great question. Okay, so because the first one was 217 pages, and then I said, I want them to all look the same on the shelf. Because with Harry Potter, sorry, I love her books. I'm on record as saying this. But with Harry Potter, they started off pretty thin, and then they got really fat, and then they kind of went to thin again. And it was like, wait, did I just get cheated on that? I don't want there to be any question about that. But what's interesting about writing a Wimpy Kid book is it's like putting together a puzzle, because it's tough to do, because you know that the story has to end at page 217. And I think there's something fun about figuring out that challenge. So thank you very much.
Yeah, good question.
Thank you.
You have another question? You good?
Thank you.
Thanks.
All right, now we'll go back over to your question.
Hi, Mr. Kini. I would like to share an experience with you, because I'm Brazilian.
Ah.
And I use it to write for kids in a newspaper, and I interviewed you in Brazil.
Oh, nice.
And before I interviewed you, it was amazing, because, we have this huge line of children in Brazil, and Mr. Kini skipped his lunch just to speak with children and sign some books. So
well, the food
it
there
was great.
The food was and terrible there, so. I'm kidding.
We really appreciate it.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.
And my question is, do you think that we have to listen to children more, to not just to write for them, but
That's a good question. First of all, I love going to Brazil. I've been twice now, and it's called Diário de um Banana over there. And so it's Diary of a Banana. And I said, well, what does banana mean in your country? And they're like, it means banana, right? That's it. It's a banana, right? So they call it the banana. And Brazil, oddly, is one of the top-selling countries in the world of Wimpy Kid. And one of the ways that they deliver the book, they deliver it, I don't know if you know this, but a large number of the books are delivered by canoe. And they go up, you know, up the river and get it to people who can't get books, and they sell them in a more affordable version. So Brazil is a special place in my heart. Yes, of course, I think we need to listen to kids more. I think that what I really learned, especially in thinking that the Diary of a Wimpy Kid books were for adults, is that that I discounted the idea that the kids might get it. You know, that they might get the humor. So I think that for me personally, I needed to respect the kids more and respect that they have this sense of humor. And even if the sense of humor is more sophisticated than I thought, and even if they don't get it, and you mentioned this before, is that if they don't get it, sometimes it's just as good because there is an aspirational quality to it. They know there's something that's supposed to be funny and they're willing to find out what that is. And I saw that with my own son, Grant. He read it too young, at age 7, and I mentioned the joke about the worm on the stick. And Grant didn't, we said, why do you think this is funny? And he didn't know, and he got mad, and he swore off the Wimpy Kid books. And then a year later, he opened them again, and I quizzed him, and he understood. And there's that moment between probably age 7 or 8 or 8 and 9, when kids get irony, and I try to keep that in mind now as I write. Thank you. I met Shusha, by the way. Did you know that?
Okay, the next question, and then you're getting ready. I think this will be the last question.
First of all, I wanted to say, hi, Alan. It's Clarice Poole. I live 5 minutes from Alan, and it was a treat to see that you were on the panel. I did not know that, and it was also a treat to listen to you, Mr. Kinney. I work at Stonegate Elementary in Montgomery County Public Schools in the library, and I like to pride myself on reading a lot of the books, and unfortunately, Diary of a Wimpy Kid is one that I had not read until about a month ago. I grabbed it as I was going for a root canal, but it turns out the dentist was late, and I read the whole thing, and I'm laughing to myself in this chair, and I'm thinking all these things. No wonder the kids love these books, boys and girls alike. And I'm thinking it's a great read aloud. I don't know of any teacher in our school that reads it aloud, which they should, because they're teachable moments. For, you know, I know that there are things that are in that the kids could not possibly understand that I laughed, and then we could talk about when I was a kid, that kind of thing. I mean, Greg gives us a plethora of cause and effect, you know, and problem solving, and I just think it's a wonderful series that you write. Also, in our school, kids want to check out the thick books, and a lot of times they're checking out the Harry Potter books that they don't read. But Diary of a Wimpy Kid makes them feel very special. They feel like they're getting a bang for their buck, and I just wanted to say thank you for writing. And boys, you know, there are a lot of girl reluctant readers too, and the Jeff Kinneys and the John Sheshkas and even James Patterson now. I mean. Has gotten on that bandwagon, and I wanted to say thank you. But there's one thing that you mentioned about when transferring to the movies, you said you had to make everything like a happy ending, or why?
You do. I think that when you put people in a theater and turn off the lights, you're creating a contract with them where you say, I'm going to deliver an emotionally satisfying story. An emotionally satisfying story has certain beats that you need to fill out. So I could have my next book, I'm writing it now, it could have a totally arch ending. And sometimes at the end of my books, I do subvert what a typical story would be. But you can't do that in film because it won't test well, and people won't like it. You always end up with the kind of the rote, formulaic ending on movies. And it's a good thing. There's a good thing. Can we get this young lady before we...
No, I'm sorry. I thought you all were together. Of course you can ask your question. Yeah. You will have the final question.
Okay, so I would just like to start off by saying that I really love your books and I'm really excited for the next one.
Thank you.
But what percentage of your life or your kids' lives is incorporated into Greg's life?
My mother would say 100%. I would say in the first books that there was a lot of, I'd say everything is, very little is true in fact, but all of it is true in spirit. I think that almost every kernel, like can you name a funny moment from any of the books right off the top of your head? And I can tell you if it was true or not. You could even open up that book to a page and look.
Oh, yeah. I like, on one page, it said, like, in the black and white photos, it was like nobody's smiling. So it can't be that fun in the olden days.
Well, actually, in our house, in Grandma's house, there's these picture of these miserable looking people. And it was like, was life really bad back then? Or did they not know to smile? So most of the ideas in the book come from, I think the better ideas in my books come from real life. And the further I go along, the more I have to use my imagination. I envy you because you've got a whole childhood of things happening around you that you can write about one day. You have easily 10, 20 Diary of a Wimpy Kid-like books if you just know what to capture, if you just write it down, if something funny happens to you, just write it down because you will use it later on. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
That's great.
Well, as I mentioned at the start of tonight's presentation, we wanted to inspire you tonight to learn something new and to use it with a child, wherever your child may be, in your home or in your classroom or in your neighborhood. And it's been just such a wonderful pleasure to have you share your experiences, Jeff. Thank you so much for taking time.
Thank you very much.